Hello there. At the time of this recording, SpaceX has two fully built Starship prototype tanks ready for testing. However, they are currently building a third one, and while SN5 and SN6 are made out of 301 stainless steel, the SN8 will be made out of 304L stainless steel. This is a significant switch, and Elon or SpaceX did not share much about the reasons behind it, which gives us a great opportunity to brush up some basic mechanical engineering knowledge and come up with some good guesses as to why they think that 304L stainless steel is better for Starship prototypes. This is going to be a deep dive, so get comfortable. In fall of 2018, Elon announced switching from carbon fiber to stainless steel, even after successfully building and testing 12-meter diameter humongous carbon fiber tank. The motivation behind this change has been in depth covered by others, so if you're interested in that, I recommend you a video from Everyday Astronaut on this topic. This video is about the differences between 301 and 304L stainless steels, and what differences does the 304L stainless steel bring for Starship? Both 301 and 304 stainless steel are so-called austenitic stainless steels, which means that they have similar crystalline structure, are non-magnetic, and then contain high level of chromium and nickel and low level of carbon. The chromium and nickel provide good corrosion resistance, and because of that, they're among the most commonly used steels in the world. The 301 is used for springs and coils. The 304 contains even higher level of chromium and less carbon, which makes it more corrosion resistant, and that's why it's used for kitchen equipment and pots. Look at this kitchen, you could build three Starships out of that. The fact is that the high resistance to chemical corrosion made the 304 stainless steel the most commonly used stainless steel in the world. And finally, the letter L in 304L stainless steel denotes even lower level of carbon. While the regular 304 can have up to 0.08% of carbon, the 304L can have up to 0.03. Finally, let's get to the first possible reason. Did SpaceX switch to 304L stainless steel because the 301 was not strong enough? Or was it too brittle? Well, to answer this, we need a refresher in basic mechanical engineering terminology and tools. The behavior of a material under stress is usually described by so-called stress-strain curve. Let's say that we are investigating basic properties of a metal. We make a sample from this metal in the shape of a rod and then place this sample onto a machine capable of slowly stretching it. As we start stretching the rod by an increasing amount, we monitor how much force the machine has to use. We also divide the force by the cross-sectional area of the sample in order to make it independent of the sample thickness. As the metal starts stretching, we see a linear relationship between the increase in length and the pressure that is needed to stretch it. This is called elastic deformation, because if we let go, the sample returns back into its original length and form. However, as we continue this process, at some point the behavior changes. Suddenly, the relationship is not linear anymore, and we entered into the region of plastic deformation, which means that the sample is now unable to fully return into its original form. The point of transition between elastic and plastic deformation is called the yield point, and the required pressure associated with it is called yield strength. At some further point, the pressure reaches maximum after which the material starts to neck and eventually breaks. The value of maximum is called ultimate tensile strength, and the strain value at break is called elongation. The engineers usually design so that the stress on all parts remains safely under the yield strength. Depending on an application, different material properties are required. An ideal steel would be strong and ductile, which would mean that it takes a lot of force to stretch and it could stretch a lot before breaking. However, in practice, there is a trade-off between those properties. The strongest steel will be brittle. Think of ceramics, for example. It takes a lot of force to stretch, but once it stretches just by a little, it breaks, because it's not ductile. Most alloys, including steel, can be made stronger or more ductile with a specific aftertreatment. Steel can be made harder, but of course more brittle, by a process of work hardening, for example, cold rolling. Ductility is increased by so-called annealing, which is a process of heating up the steels by several hundreds of degrees for a prolonged time, which allows the internal structure to reshape itself into the original unstressed form. Now we can really go back to the original question. Is 304L steel stronger than 301? I will make a reasonable assumption here that the Starship will experience the highest structural loads during the launch, because that's when it's full of fuel and therefore the heaviest. That means that we are most interested in comparison between those steels at cryogenic temperatures, corresponding to liquid oxygen and methane. This plot shows the value of yield strength based on the material's temperature. Remember that the yield strength is the pressure value at which the material becomes permanently deformed. The higher it is, the more force it takes to stretch it. As mentioned before, a single steel alloy comes in many flavors based on their aftertreatment. For this plot, I drew both extreme versions of the respective alloys, the strongest, fully hardened, and the most ductile made by so-called annealing. And by the way, if you are interested, I will link the original data sources below in the description. The conclusion from this data is simple. The 301 stainless steel has higher yield strength at any temperature. So, the material strength at cryogenic temperatures cannot be the reason for switching to 304L. But, I hear you ask, what about ductility? This is a similar plot to the previous one, except the yield strength axis has been replaced with elongation, which denotes how much a sample can stretch before breaking. High value means high ductility. If you look at the room temperature region on the right of the plot, the 301 steel is more ductile. That must be why it is used for springs and coils. However, for the cryogenic temperatures around the two vertical lines, the 301 becomes more brittle, but the 304L remains much more ductile for both full hard and annealed versions. Is that enough of a reason for switching the steel type? We actually do have one hint from Elon about why they switched to 304L. In his tweet, he said that it has higher toughness at cryogenic temperatures. Well, if toughness is the reason, we have to dive into its engineering definition. Thanks, Elon! Remember this original stress-strain plot that I drew before? Well, the toughness is defined as the amount of energy a material can take before breaking. The value of toughness is determined by the area under the curve until the failure point. It is a combination of both strength and ductility, and to have a high toughness value, it has to be good at both. There is an ingeniously simple method for measuring toughness of real samples. It's called Sharpie impact test. This test uses a prepared material sample, usually with a notch machined in the middle. The notch is there to simulate a surface imperfection and give the material an opportunity to develop a fracture. The other part of the system is a pendulum, which is designed to break the sample. First, the pendulum is released from a fixed height, and the point where it stops on the other side is recorded. Based on the pendulum's mass and achieved height, the potential energy at that point can be computed. Then, the sample is placed into the holder, and the pendulum is released again. When the sample gets hit by it, it breaks. But the process of breaking the sample slowed the pendulum down, because some of its energy was used to break it. Now the pendulum will not reach as high as before, and the difference between the potential energies of the free swing and this swing equals to how much energy it took to break the sample, which is exactly how we defined the toughness before. Let's now look at some toughness measurements from both types of steel, but before we do, let's make this test even more realistic. Starships are made out of many sheets of steel welded together, so the weakest point will always be the weld. So having the samples on pendulum made out of two pieces welded together will provide us information about its weldability. Here are the toughness data for the two types of welded steels at cryogenic temperatures. Unfortunately, I could not find the data for direct comparison between 301 and 304L, but I found two separate comparisons between 301 and 304, and between 304 and 304L, so that should do nicely. While the 301 welds are slightly stronger at higher temperatures, at cryogenic temperatures, the strength of the 304 welds is 4 times stronger. Now that's a good argument for building Starship from 304. There is a partial solution to this weakening of welds at cold temperatures, and that is treating the finished welds by annealing, which consists of heating down the welded part to roughly 1000 degrees Celsius for half an hour, and then cooling it down. This process clearly improves the toughness of both 301 and 304 steel, but annealed 304 is still significantly tougher. I think that at this point in time in Starship construction, annealing the welds is impossible to do. Maybe when the welds are made robotically. So far we have shown the advantage of 304 steel over 301 in toughness of welds at cryogenic temperatures. But what about 304L? At minus 196 degrees centigrade, which is close to the temperature of liquid oxygen, the 304L provides additional 25% toughness over the regular 304 steel. There is one more advantage of 304L steel over both 301 and 304, and it's related to its low carbon content. When heated to high temperatures, for instance by welding, the chrome and carbon react to form areas that are more susceptible to both cracks and corrosion. Finally, I think we figured it out. The motivation behind the switch from 301 to 304L stainless steel seems to be all about welding. Even though 304L itself is weaker, its welds at cryogenic temperatures are much stronger and much less prone to corrosion. This switch should allow SpaceX to keep the welds of Starship as they are when finished, without any complicated, expensive, or even impossible aftertreatment. I hope you enjoyed this detective story with me. This is the first video I ever made, so if you like it, please subscribe. And if you didn't like it, please leave some nice constructive criticism in the comments. I have about 20 topics lined up, from fundamentals of spaceflight, how to get to space, to different subsystems of International Space Station. So please subscribe and thank you for watching.